So we've been in a series of messages from the book of Acts. We're working our way through it. And I seem to, Chris gets the really nice passages where people agree and stuff. And I get the ones that have a lot of tension and conflict in them. I don't know why that is. It's a magnetic pull of my DNA or something. But years ago, I was invited to a day-long dialogue at the Directors Guild of America down in Hollywood, and it was 50 filmmakers, directors, actors, people in the film industry, and 50 pastors or Christian leaders, and we'd sit around and talk and explore what's happening in film and our faith and all those dynamics. And one of the things that I took away from that was besides the ashtrays, I can put those. Another thing that was that they asked the question, what makes something interesting? What makes a movie interesting? What makes you want to watch it? And people had different things, a really good story or character development or dialogue or the way it's written or the cinematography. Everybody had their own perspective. And one director got up and he was actually the one who did Pet Detective, remember, Jim Carrey? And he was sitting at my table and he stood up and he said, the only thing that makes a film interesting is conflict. When there's conflict, suddenly it's interesting. And over the years, I thought about that. And I thought, well, our life should be pretty interesting then, There's all kinds of religious, but you could go into Barnes & Noble and go to the religion section and read through several books about different religions. And one thing you won't find in them is conflict. They tend to just kind of float along. Everybody getting along, everybody doing better. And one of the greatest arguments for the authenticity of Scripture is that it doesn't shy away from conflict. You'd think they would just talk about it in Acts. Well, and the church just went out and the gospel was preached and people's lives were changed and nothing went wrong. But that's not what Acts is all about. And so today we're going to look at one of those conflicts. And it's Acts 15, which is the same chapter that we looked at last week when Chris was teaching to us about the Council of Jerusalem and the big debates that they had and the disagreements that they worked through. And at the end of it, verse 36, sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the brothers and sisters in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord. Let's see how they're doing. Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them, but Paul did not think it was wise to take him because he deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. They had such a violent disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took John Mark and sailed for Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas and left, commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord, and he went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. So Lord, teach us from this conflict. It seems small, as most of ours are, but it gets big, as most of ours do. So teach us and grow us in your grace. Amen. Anybody here ever have a conflict? Fortunately, I never have. it's nice to be with people who do. No, yeah, there's something about them. They usually start out fairly small, and they grow, and they get bigger, and then they swamp the boat. The interesting thing in this chapter in Acts is that it begins with a really big conflict. It starts out, as we saw last week, that Paul and Barnabas are upset about what's being forced on the new believers, and they can't stand it any longer, and so they go to the Jerusalem church to have a fight, right? And to get this straightened out. And in the midst of it, Peter hears the message and talks to them about grace. And he says in verse 10, Now, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? Why do you do that? Why do you make it harder for the new people than for the old timers? We believe it's through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we're saved. That's how it happens. And they come to an agreement, and they actually work out, as we heard last week, they write a letter saying the Gentiles are welcomed into the family, and here's some conditions, and they're not going to be treated harshly or second class, and the problem's resolved. But why do we put on people a yoke? Why do we do that? Why do we make it hard? Why do we have things that people in our relationships that make things harder than they are? Long time ago, and I wrote about this in Coloring Outside the Lines. You probably have heard it 1,000 times, so forgive me. But we did that trip through leaf peeping land on the East Coast that the Murdys just went to last week. How was it?
Great.
Yeah, beautiful. Still okay. So nothing's changed. Okay, same old thing, same trees. And we were doing that, and we went to this little town in Massachusetts called Sturbridge Village. Remember that? Everybody's like colonial America, and everybody's the same as they were a couple hundred years ago. And Eileen was in the quilt shop talking with the quilting ladies, and that actually hasn't changed much. I was out talking to the farmer. That was one of the most boring conversations I'd ever had. But they leaned against the fence with the farmer, and he's the oxen are out there, you know, and the and he's explaining to me, you know, like I need to know. Well, you know, you have the big oxen, you have a little new young oxen. We put the yoke on the big oxen, you know, we yoke them together, and they go along, because without that, the young ox would veer off and make bad lines for the plants. And so pretty soon they get stronger, and they learn to stay in line, and they don't get distracted, and they just keep moving along the line the way we want them to. And then we split the team, and we move the now trained one over, and we bring in another new one, and we continue the process, and we just keep training them all so they stay in line. That's what we do. We yoke them. And I thought that was brilliant, right? And I thought, I've got to get a yoke and put it over my desk at UPress, in a little office that was down in the hole, you know, and with that little verse, take my yoke upon me and learn me, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So I did that, except that every time I try and bolt the thing into the wall, it's so heavy, it would pull out of the plaster and crash down on the desk. And then I'd put it back up again, and it would crash down again. And I realized, this is not the yoke of Christ. This is not what the Bible's talking about. I've got it completely wrong, right? And so when they talk about, you know, why do you want to put a yoke on somebody? Well, the reason we put it on them is so they'll stay in line, so they won't get distracted, so they'll be like us, and everybody will be in agreement, and we'll all be the same. That's why we put the yoke on. Now, I'm glad to hear from Scripture that the goal of the Holy Spirit in our lives is not to make us all the same. And it's not to make us stay in line. And it's not to keep us from looking up and walking away or anything like that. That's not it. The Holy Spirit works in us so that we become more of who we really are. And we become more of what God made us to be. And there's no need for a yoke. There's no need for a burden. I think that this Acts 15 passage is a brilliant, brilliant study in how we can come together with really strong opposing views, and we can present it with integrity, and we can come to a solution and a resolution, and we can move forward in grace. And that's a great thing, really, isn't it? We don't see much of that these days, but we can do it. And there's nothing wrong with having a disagreement and coming together and fighting it out. As long as the goals are the same, we can have different strategies. You know, Damien was telling me that there's an old saying in AA, how does a new AA group start? And he said, you get a coffee pot and an argument, and you get a new AA group. You have to have the coffee pot. That's it. I thought, well, that's the way most churches start, too. That's totally the way it is. And but what happens when it gets personal? See, they were debating issues. They were debating theology. They were debating various strategies for mission, right? And they came from two different perspectives. The Jerusalem church was the holding church. They were the keepers of the tradition. They were the place that you come to and kind of a temple gathering church. And then the Antioch church was multilingual, multi-ethnic, multiracial, and very, very diverse and outgoing. They're the ones who sent the first mission. Paul and Barnabas were sent out as missionaries from Antioch, not from Jerusalem. So you have this different strategy with the same goals. And it can work unless it becomes personal. So we get to the end of this chapter, and it suddenly becomes personal. Now, throughout the chapter, you can see, verse 2, they brought Paul and Barnabas in sharp dispute with the church in Jerusalem. Paul and Barnabas were appointed to go and argue. The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Paul and Barnabas telling them about the miraculous wonders they'd seen. Over and over again. And choose some of their own people and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. Always mentioned together. And now we see Paul and Barnabas coming into a personal conflict. Let's go back out. Barnabas wants to take John Mark. Paul doesn't want to do it. No way. He let us down. I'm not going to have him in the group. And they had such a sharp disagreement, some translations say violent, that they parted company. Never again are they mentioned in the Bible together, ever. From this moment on, you will never see Paul and Barnabas mentioned together. It was a dividing line. It's small, it's a few verses, right? But profoundly changed the tone of the emerging church in Acts. Never again mentioned together. Up to that point, in one chapter, they're mentioned together about 8 times. Oh, in every context. You didn't have one without the other, right? No. Can't be settled. Can't be resolved. Now, why is it difficult when it gets personal? What makes it difficult? Over the years, I've seen a few conflicts in the church. And, you know, I remember there's one that turned really wild. I was a pastor of the church in Walnut Creek, and we had an issue that came up around the youth ministry. And we would have big discussions into the night about what to do, how to reach kids, how to spend money, how to handle things, how to make sure things were safe, all those kinds of discussions that you'd have in a church, you know, that really supports youth ministry. But there was this point in time where it turned, and there were a few people that said, the problem is the youth pastor. He's the problem. And from that moment on, there was no discussion. There was no way to resolve anything. There was no way to talk about issues anymore because the problem's him. And I went on a vacation to Hawaii and I got a phone call that while we're there, like the second day there, they had rallied around and fired the youth pastor with his wife, 8 months pregnant. With no, what do you call that when you get paid a little bit afterwards? With no severance. How could they do that? What would happen? Why would they do that? And it's because the problem stopped being the problem and it now became the person. And when that happens, there is no way to work it out. You've probably seen this in your work, in your neighborhood, wherever. And if we could get back to what the issues are, there's hope, but when it's personal, there's not. Because I mean, we're seeing this with our presidential election, aren't we? It's become very personal. It's not issues. It's not strategies. It's not vision. It's not how do we move forward together as a country. Nothing like that. It's all about bang, 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 bang. And it becomes torturous to watch. I got my hopes up when I heard there wasn't going to be another debate, and I thought, oh, good, phew, that'll save an evening. Now I heard there might be one anyway, but you know, you've seen it. You've seen it, you've felt it, you've been in them, and it's a tragic thing. So I think what is the only thing that can help us when we reach this level of conflict? There's only one thing, and it's a gift. It's grace. Grace is the only thing that rescues us from unresolvable personal conflicts. You know, was this a terrible thing that Paul and Barnabas split up? Yeah, I don't think they were proud of it, you know. They probably defended it to this day. I can just hear Barnabas going, oh, nobody trusted you. Nobody liked you. You were off by yourself, and I went and got you, and I brought you to Antioch, and we taught together, and you learned, and I was the one who got you when nobody else trusted you, and I put my reputation on the line for you, and you won't do anything for John Mark? That's right, I won't. There's a Myers-Briggs test that some companies use to evaluate your personality, your temperament, all those kind of things to help employees get along. And one of the categories in it is, are you a thinker or a feeler, T or F? And people who are Fs, like Barnabas, they are empathetic, they care about people, they wonder what the impact of something is on people around them, and they're very caring and feeling. The thinkers are strategic and the facts, and this is the way it is. Paul was a T. So actually, if they had the Myers-Briggs test, they might have been able to work something out here. Because you had the T versus the F. But neither would give. Neither would give. And so does that mean that God stopped working? Does that mean that the church shut down? Does that mean that nobody came to Jesus from then on? No. Isn't that weird? They went off their own way. More churches were encouraged. The letters to the churches that Paul wrote from prison, and that was all done after Barnabas had walked away. John Mark ends up writing the first gospel, the Gospel of Mark. We never would have had that if Barnabas hadn't have said, come with me, just like he'd said to Paul a few years earlier. So the benefits went out either way. God's going to use us either way, whatever side of an argument you're on. The question is, can we experience grace? One of the great conflicts in the Old Testament, Jacob and Esau, talks about in Genesis. Two brothers, twins. One of them, his name meant Harry, and the other one, they meant ankle grabber, because he tried to pull it a little back so he could get out first. And you know the story that Jacob betrayed Esau, stole his inheritance, stole his legacy, stole everything. Got conned the mother, talked the mother into coming on his side, and tricking the father, and turned family against family, and manipulated, controlled, stole everything, and then fled so that Esau wouldn't kill him. Because Esau was big and tough and could hurt him. So they lived their whole lives apart, Jacob in dread of Esau. And then in Genesis 32, it's very strange because after a lifetime of running, hiding, and feeling guilty. Jacob looked up, and there was Esau coming with 400 men. He found him. He's coming after him with 400 men. And Jacob's terrified. So he divided the children among his wives and the maidservants. He put the maidservants and their children out in front. Always the coward. Let's put them out front first to get killed. And then stagger everything up. And was all ready for this huge battle. And it says, but Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him and threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. And Esau looked up and saw the women and children and said, what are they for? And Esau says, I already have plenty. I already have plenty. I don't need anything. I don't need anything from you. I don't need anything. I just wanted my brother back. They could have spent a lifetime at war. I mean, in my family, you know, we went well over 20 years without my brother and I speaking to each other, and I never knew why. Family get-togethers, I'd go up and say, hi, how you doing? They'd turn and walk away. Not even a hello. And I just accepted it after a while, you know, that's just the way it is. And never a Christmas card or anything like that. Never knew why. But it went on for decades. That's how strong it is when it's personal. Now, he and I are friends, and he called me yesterday, and we talked a little bit, and we texted some, and I thought, well, I've got a brother. I have a brother. It took 50 years to do something with him, but I've got a brother. And I felt maybe that's a little what Jacob and Esau felt. That after a while, the fight didn't even matter anymore. Grace is discovery that we have enough. We have enough. We don't need to look around. We don't need to see what others are doing or not doing. We don't need to protect or defend or attack. We have enough. And when we have enough, grace has a way of washing in and saying, there is so much in your life to be thankful for. Things that go unnoticed. One of my favorite writers was Lou Smeads. He was an ethicist, but he actually wrote some good things. And I want to read this a little bit long, okay? I'm sorry. But I want you to just let the words and the vision wash over you as he writes this. Grace is too unpredictable. It is too lavish. Too delicious for us to stay sober about it. What can you do with such unchecked generosity but to smack your lips, slosh it around your tongue, and savor it with joy? I taste grace when a friend for no reason at all tells me she loves me. I see it when my left leg goes where I tell it to go. I feel it when I take a deep breath of smog-free air. He lived in Pasadena. So he didn't have that very often. I savor it when the woman I've loved for 40 years murmurs, strokes me, and asks me to move over to my side of the bed and give her some room to curl up beside me. I sense it as I wonder at the improbable oddity that all these thinking minds and feeling hearts and talking tongues should walk about on two legs, bustling around me on this one little globe in an immense universe that is itself floating among a trillion lifeless universes. I savor it most happily when I accept the fact that I am accepted as I am, with my ogres, with my demons and my angels, with my blundered past, my frail virtues all mixed together. undeserving. Yet were they at the same time accepted by the maker and keeper of the universe? How do you savor grace? How do you savor grace? Is it by putting a yoke on somebody? Getting them to line up? Is it by noticing what a blessing our life is? Whether it's the way we intended it to be or not, whether it's turned out the way we want or not, can you say, like Esau, brother, I have enough. I have enough. I didn't come here for anything. I think that's grace. I think that's grace. I think that also tells us what kind of church we're becoming. I don't think we're ever going to be a church that says this is the way it's got to be. It's all line up and get our turn in the yoke. If you want to do that, I actually have the yoke up in the attic. It's almost right there, actually. And with a little effort, it can crash down through. It really can. Or we can be the place that says, you know, God is good. And he's good to us with all our stuff. Let's be that. So, Lord Jesus, come into our lives, come into our hearts once more. And Lord, we thank you that you don't give up on us and you love us and you pursue us with all of our stuff. And you don't leave us here. You take us forward. So we ask for your healing, we ask for your mercy, and we ask for your grace. All things that you've offered freely. In Jesus' name, amen.